greetings. Matthew 24:36. But of that day and hour no one knows, not even the angels of heaven nor the Son, but the Father alone. We're all familiar with that verse, right? No one knows. We rightly take that to mean no one knows the day nor the hour, right? But what about guessing? Is hoping and guessing and longing a sin? Consider this. The statement, no man knows, should not be taken to mean God will not come, nay, God cannot come, if someone is expecting him at that day and hour. God will not come and God cannot come if someone happens to guess he will come at that day and hour. Keep following and pay close attention. We cannot make Jesus return at a time we demand or we expect. But can we prevent his return? What exactly does that even mean, right? If I, for example, began to preach and teach that Jesus will return on a given day, for example, Tuesday, September 11th, 2018, would that teaching then somehow prevent Jesus' return on that day, assuming he has not come before then? It would seem strange to imagine such would be the case. We cannot make him come, nor can we prevent his coming. And yet no man knows, right? Could a group of 100,000 atheists, schooled in hyperliteralism, try to stop the return of the Lord by assigning shifts? Shifts when one or more atheists would go about knowing their hour and day was the time of Christ's return. Each atheist is simply assigned 1 hour on one day, 24 per day, 365 days per year. And for each hour or each assigned day, they claim to know that their hour is the hour of Jesus' return. Could they make God a liar or prevent his return? If Jesus returned at an hour of their knowing, would that then make Jesus' statement false? Certainly not, because claiming one knows is vastly different than actually knowing with certainty. Such an effort would be foolish on its face and laughable in its presumption. But how does this relate to sincere believers? You would have to examine and ponder hope, longing, desire, and belief. We live our lives based on our belief and our expectancy which arises from our belief. 2 Peter 3:11, since all these things are to be destroyed in this way, it is clear what sort of people you should be in holy conduct and godliness. Our knowledge of the world's impending destruction should form and shape what sort of people we are. Hebrews 10:25, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. To see the day approaching, drawing near, it must be recognizable. There must be some aspect, some details which will rationally lead one to conclude, hey, this looks a lot like the description of the day of the Lord. It sure seems like it is going to happen soon. That does not translate into setting a date. The Lord will return on his timeline, not on command. There is nothing wrong with actively looking forward to his return. In fact, if you are not excited about his potential return, I'm concerned for you. Philippians 3:20, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Hebrews 9:28. So also the Messiah, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. Bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. In my heart, I feel that is an active waiting. Active waiting would mean paying attention as you wait, aware that you are, in fact, looking for some event. Waiting for some event. Titus 2:12 through 14. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness, and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. James 5:7 through 9. Be patient then, brothers, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, and how patient he is for the autumn and spring rains. You too, be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near. Don't grumble against each other, brothers, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door. Notice that 2,000 years ago, James wrote, the Lord's coming is near. You might be a liberal Christian if that verse completely shapes and undermines your thinking. If you resonate that near 2,000 years ago trumps and crushes any thought of soon, instead be a glass half full Christian. We're now 2,000 years closer to something that was near only 2,000 years ago. Revelation 3:11, I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have, so that no one will take your crown. Him who overcomes I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will he leave it. It is true, no man knows. No one has knowledge with certainty. But if you are a mature believer, you should recognize the signs. Something inside you should be excited with the expectation, hoping for the shout, the bridegroom comes. Knowing with certainty, that is the salient factor. Many decades ago, in high school in fact, I had a teacher who wagered candy bars on quizzes. Did you think you got 100% on the quiz? He would ask. Who wants to wager a candy bar to demonstrate their confidence? Demonstrate their certainty. Knowledge with certainty. That is what Jesus described. No man had knowledge with certainty. I admit I have not had a direct, specific, revelatory word from Almighty God. But I'd be willing to bet a candy bar on the last trump of a feast of trumpets. And just for the record, I did actually win 2 that semester. Keep your heart and your mind on the Lord, and look up, for your redemption draws near. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.